Hey, what we have here is what I believe is a 3D representation of an airplane fuselage model that was posted on the CamBam forum by Lapis Latundra at something. Lapis Latundra at Hotmail is his username. I'd suggest Lappies that you change your username so that people don't gather that up and send you spam. Anyway, he uploaded this wanting some help with some basic getting started on how to machine this 3D part. So I'm gonna have a tackle at it. Here we go. First thing I noticed is that it was in metric, and I'm used to working in inches, so I just copied it from a metric opening of CamBam to an inch opening of CamBam. Now I'm going to scale it. Transform, resize. Okay, where'd my resize window go? Transform, resize. There it is. Millimeters to inches. Apply. Okay. Now I'm going to move this down into my main work area. Even in inches, the units are going to be fairly large from what I'm seeing here. Tool, let's get an idea how big. Tools, get object extremis. 28 inches long. Okay, so something suitable for a CNC router or a foam machine, but maybe not for the average milling, at least not the average home shop milling machine. Let's take a look at a couple things. First thing I noticed is that it's completely above the work plane. The work plane being the plane defined by X and Y usually on most milling machines. So what I would probably do is align. I wouldn't move X and Y for now. Oh, we can. We'll just center it for now. Apply. And then set it at the upper limit. Apply. Now, if we look at it, it is below the work plane with the highest most point on the model at Z equals 0. And that seems like it might be efficient, but the reality is that if you try and cut that, you may wind up with some issues. If your stock isn't perfectly uniform, if you didn't skim it off, etc. So typically I would take something like that and I would move it a little bit down below the work plane, just so that I'm sure that I'll get a fully machined surface on the part. So I'd come down here to transform, and I'd translation means move along the Z-axis, say a tenth of an inch. Apply. Okay. Now the part is, well, let's look at it side on. There we go. Actually, I can't really tell that that moved. And you know what? It did move in the wrong direction. That's funny. And since we're zoomed in here, we can see that there's a potential issue and artifact right along the center line of this. So this may be a bad model to work from, but we'll give it our best shot. Anyway, let's fix that. It translated up a tenth of an inch. Let's translate it down a tenth of an inch. Okay, now it's fully below the work plane. Now the first thing I'd do would be to create a 3D operation from that part. We can try 3D waterline, waterline rough, inside outside offsets where it starts doesn't matter. We'll change that to selected shape since we're not using any kind of margin. The target depth was automatic based on the model, and let's just use, I don't know, a half inch, or let's use a quarter inch end mill to rough it. Now, I have no idea what he's going to be machining this out of, and my machines and speeds and depth of cut and all of that may be totally off for the part. I'm just trying to quickly get a rough machining operation that might help get him started. Mixed machining is faster usually, although with waterline it doesn't really make any difference. We may want to add a boundary margin to this just to cut some clearance around the part. So let's see if I, where's that boundary margin, say, of an extra quarter inch. I'll make it a third inch. That's going to cut a little bit larger than the part, remove that much material. But remember, this is a roughing operation. We're removing material. I'm not going to worry about the speeds and feeds or any of that. I am going to take some aggressive, say, 0.375. I'm going to take some aggressive cuts so that it'll generate quickly. 50% step over, you know, not 50 times step over, 50% step over, 0.5. And we're going to hit Control T and see if this thing renders in a reasonable amount of time. I actually already tried this on my house computer, and it didn't like it much. Well, it's going. We're down to an inch and a quarter, inch and an eighth. Remember, though, that this is 3-point-something inches tall, so it's going to take a minute. Here we go. It's still calculating. Hey, we got a rough operation to do the job. All right. Took multiple layers, about 3/8 of an inch deep per pass. Removed all of that. Didn't come up with any errors. Maybe it's and I actually had an error on this on waterline roughing when I did this before, but again, I wasn't using such aggressive numbers. All right, so let's go ahead and save this. File, save as. We'll save it on the desktop. Fuselage test. Save. All right, tools, simulate with chymotics. This is going to take just as long to generate as it did the first time. We're just going to go ahead and do it on the desktop for now. And then we get to sit here and wait. I got enough time to tell a joke or two. At the moment, I can't think of one. So you're just going to have to sit there impatiently, twiddling your fingers and drumming your fingers on the desktop and tapping your toe, waiting for this to generate so that we can see what we'll get from that waterline roughing operation. Oh, we're at 0.1875 depth. 2.25, it's going. We're close. And any moment now. All right. Now we've got chymotics up. And let's turn the tool pads off, rotate this up, and look and see what we got. Yeah, it's about what I expected. It's kind of rough, stair-stepped, so on. It actually is showing some artifacts because I don't believe I have my quarter-inch end mill set as having a flute that long in my tool table. But anyway, you get it, basically get a rough, stair-stepped shape. Now, the next thing I might do would be to do a finish or semi-finish pass. And I'm not going to get too fancy with this one either. I'm just going to make a couple copies of the original. And I'm going to change it from horizontal or to horizontal with horizontal hatch. Let's get a top view. And we'll, doesn't matter really where we start since we've already roughed it. Top. Since this is a finish pass, I don't think we need any boundary margin. So we'll set that back to zero. And then, well, we'll stay with the end mill for now. He can worry about finishing with ball mills and so on for other types of finishes later. But what... So what I am going to do, though, is to make sure that it cuts fully beyond the depth of the part. assuming that the stock is thick enough to do so. Is that really not going to work? Oh, okay. I'm actually cutting deeper than the model at this point, and this is purely academic. You don't necessarily, with an end mill, you know what, let's change it to a ball mill just so that we can, we'll go to a quarter inch ball mill. And the depth of the part at the way it's set up is 3.22, so we would want to go at least an eighth of an inch deeper than that. So 2.2 is close to 2.5, so we'll go 3.375. Now, what I'm going to do, since this is a finish pass, is I'm going to set depth increment to 0. Or this may be a semi-finish pass. Set depth increment to 0. And let's go ahead and turn this off for now. And we'll leave the step over at 50% for now, and then we'll adjust it in a minute. And we'll turn this one off because we're not doing anything with it. Tools, simulate with CamOptics, and we'll just use the same code. And this should generate a little bit faster. Oh, wait. Yeah, this should generate a little bit faster, just simply because it's not calculating every single depth and the step over is fairly large, but we'll see. And as you can see with that, we get a little bit different cut, and I can see a good reason to keep the water line so we can see our cut, since it only shows the material removed by the part, by the path. So let's take this and make it generate a little bit faster, maybe. Actually, you know what? Let's delete this one. And we'll use the, because it takes so long to generate the tool paths, and we'll use this one, this operation, as a roughing operation. And we'll come down here. Oh, that doesn't need to be selected shape. That needs to be... Oh, yeah, that is selected shape. We'll come down here and we'll set the depth increment at 0.25. And it'll take longer to generate code this way, but it should be faster than the water line. We'll keep it rough. You know, we'll keep it at 50% step over. And then we'll set this one to 3.75, and you set this depth based on whatever you're going to do and how you're going to set it up and if it's practical or not. Don't use these numbers. This is just showing how to get started on a project like this. And we'll set this one to the depth increment of 0. And we'll go ahead and come down here and change that to a ball mill also. And we'll change this one back to an end mill, since it's going to be a roughing pass. And let's simulate the roughing pass first. Now, I know you're just getting started, so I may use some things that aren't part of the core CamBam program. Like, I use these little view things here. These are an add-on or a plug-in that you can download. These zoom items, I believe, are plug-in add-ons. These selections here for viewing and snapping to objects are an add-on plug-in. And the interface that allows you to take your code and send it straight to CamOptics to be simulated is also a plug-in, and CamOptics is a third-party program that's actually open source, so or at least it's freeware, but I think it's open source, and so you can use that to simulate what your cut is going to look like. So let's see where we're at here. Come on, generate some code. Now I'm sitting here thinking I need to remember to tell a joke again. Except all the jokes I know are way too long or way too short. Was that a short joke? Nah, I don't think so. All right, come on. Generate some code, show us some stuff. Oh boy. This might take a minute. I may have to clip this section out of the video. Anyway, I was mentioning plugins a moment ago, so might as well show you where they're at while we're waiting. You go to the CamBam forums, and the best, most complete library of plugins that have been created by other users to go with CamBam is here. You go to the scripts and plugins, and then you come down here, plugin webpage in progress, and David has created a page with lots and lots. Oh, here we go. Now we're simulating in CamBam. Well, while that's rendering, I'm going to flip back to there. Has created a page here with a whole list of plugins available for the two current versions of CamBam that are available. I happen to be using version 1, and as you can see, there are a bunch of add-ins and plugins that you can use with the... this is different. Ah, I clicked on something totally wrong. We don't want that. The plugins are all listed over here, and it shows, and those were documentation link pages. But as you can see, there's a whole list of plugins that you can use with CamBam to, and right here is the one that's the plugin to integrate CamOtix with it. But there's a bunch more. Anyway, let's take a look. All right. That's roughly what our part will machine out to look like. And we didn't have any boundary margin, so it didn't cut off the front and rear like it would if we had had a boundary margin. So let's go back to the file here, because we want to, you know, if we're cutting this, we may want to cut all the way around it. So let's go, since this is going to be our roughing operation, we might come up here, boundary margin 0.33, and that'll cut wider. And then I'm going to try and make this run execute a little faster, just for execution's sake, or demonstration's sake. Increase the step over even further. Now let me take a quick look at my quarter inch end mill and see what I've got programmed for parameters. Now I have a half inch flute length listed, so it should not have any artifacts. So let's go back to the drawing, come down here, and let's set the depth increment to 0.5. So remember, this is roughing. We're just trying to get the bulk of the material away from the part. Then we'll come down here to this one that we're going to finish with a ball mill, and we'll leave it at 50% for now. 50% step over for now. Depth increment of 0, target depth is in excess of the depth of the part by the radius of the ball mill, just to make sure that we cut all the way down. You may not want to do it that way. You may want to finish the whole thing with the end mill, and that's fine. The end mill is going to be very close to dead on at full depth. Obviously, the ball mill, if you just went to full depth, would leave a fillet at the bottom. All right, so let's see how long this takes. Tools. Simulate with... one thing you might want to bear in mind. Sometimes from tool flexing and so on, and various other things, you can have a roughing pass, especially an aggressive roughing pass, that cuts more than you expect it to in some areas, so you may want to leave a roughing clearance. So let's leave, say, 1/100 of an inch roughing clearance. Depending on the material, that's not at all an unreasonable amount. And then in this one, we'll have 0 roughing clearance. And let's go ahead and take that down to 0.25. Step over. That's 25% of cutter diameter. And we're going to have a long time again. Tools, simulate with camotics, overwrite the existing code file, and let's, come back down here to and find our plugins. Now, one of the things I would recommend against is just installing every single plugin that's available. What you want to do, we're simulating in camotics. Looks like some of the aggressive changes I made it go a little faster. Well, still taking a minute to render. But some of that I like, 3D solid from primitives, I don't use that at all. I don't even have it installed because I use a program called ViaCAD 2D 3D Pro for all of my 3D modeling. ArcText, I actually use that sometimes. It's kind of nice for engraving on stuff to lay out a line and then do the text along and it'll follow the arc. Arrows and Dimensions, I may have that installed. I think I've tried it, but I haven't found it all that useful because usually I just click on the item to see what its sizes are or use the Object Extremas option. Center Lines, I haven't used. Curved Surface, I probably should look at that, but again, I do all of my 3D modeling in ViaCAD. Drag Knife would be really handy if you're doing stencils or vinyl lettering or anything like that. Dimensioned Objects, I haven't used. Hatch, I haven't used. Hypocycloid Generate, I don't even know what a hypocycloidal is. Lines, Custom Length and Angle, that's kind of handy once in a while. Sometimes, CamBam, you typically just draw the line from, and you click in one spot and you click in another spot. And if you have the snaps turned on, it snaps to either, well, if you have Snappy installed and you have the snaps turned on, it snaps to either here we go. It's done. And there's roughly what you wind up with. It's not cutting off on the ends, so I'm not quite sure why that is. So you might find yourself having to go back and create a 2D operation to cut off the ends of your piece, you know, of your workpiece. Well, technically, of your part. The stock is your workpiece. The part is what you cut out of it, or you cut it into, as this case may be. Anyway, that's kind of a rough getting started way to tackle the project. And then, of course, when you actually put your stock on the mill, you know, you would select a suitable zero point. In this case, my zero point is the exact center of the part. But you could set your part anywhere you wanted. Here, let's go back to CamBam. You know, if we wanted to work, say, on a machine that's got more range this way than this way, we just take this part, transform, rotate. Actually, let's do this. Transform, numerical move. That's another plugin. Has a rotate function as well as a move function. And we're just going to rotate it 90 degrees around the z-axis. And then if we wanted to work off the corner of our stock instead of off of the center of the stock, we could transform a line. Remember that one? Well, we're not going to change the depth, but... we're going to align it a little differently. We don't want to change the depth because of the reasons I explained in the beginning, or I don't want to change the depth. Now, if we touched off this corner of the stock, that would mean that this, the way we have it aligned right here, this would be the edge of the stock, and the model actually touches the edge of the stock here. And I found that, for the same reason I don't like to have my Z depth of a 3D part being exactly at Z equals zero, I don't like to have my part being exactly at the edge of the stock, unless the edge of the stock is already a finished edge. So what I would probably do is transform, move. Actually, let's do that differently. Transform, numerical move, and go back to move. And depending on how rough my stock is, I might move that an inch or a quarter an inch or a half an inch, but we'll just make it an inch. and an inch. And then when you set this up on the machine, you touch off on the top of your stock, and you set that as zero. And you touch off on this surface and this surface, and you set those as zero. Well, on this edge of the stock and this edge of the stock, and you set that as zero. And then you run your code. And your machine will then assume that this is zero, and this is where your piece is. Anyway, tackle it any way you like, but this should give you... This isn't really a tutorial on how to machine this part. This is kind of a getting started to help get you going and get you doing some stuff so you can learn some stuff and figure some stuff out on your own. I hope it's helpful.